This is the web transmission service of the Royal Canadian Military Institute. On November the 9th, the Museum of the Institute held its third annual Military History Symposium. Our theme was Canada's Second World War, Combined Arms in Victory. Our concluding speaker of the event was Dr. Geoff Hayes of the University of Waterloo on Shootin the Breeze, Morale and the Canadian Army's Anti-Heroes, 1939-45.
Please help me welcome to the podium Dr. Geoff Hayes.
Thank you, Ryan, and thank you for all your organizational efforts and that of the Museum Committee, and to the members of the RCMI for having me. It's a great privilege, and also to be here with such great educators and historians as we've heard from today. My topic is about My research now is about morale, and I realize that I'm in charge of your morale in several ways. First of all, I'll assume that after such a wonderful dinner, your morale has dramatically improved. Not any function of the speakers, but just the extent of the day, and some of you I can tell were heading towards the bar. My morale, in contrast, is slipping because I've yet to have a drink. But that's another story. That doesn't sound very good, does it? Especially for the young people here. Anyway, my interest in morale has come up through a variety of sources and a variety of discussions that I've had with historians, particularly British historians, who've been recently talking about questions relating to morale in the British Army during the Second World War. And the idea of defining and the idea of doing something about morale has been an important feature of some of this recent literature. And I decided that I would look at morale in a Canadian perspective because I'm fairly convinced that the Brits, as much as we love them, have got the story wrong when it comes to Canada for a variety of reasons. But I'll take that up with Jonathan Fennell when I see him next. Let me just talk about morale for a moment and try to understand and try to fit my discussion of heroes and anti-heroes into that broader discussion. It turns out that morale is an extremely difficult thing to define. And yet, all of us kind of know what it is. And as I said, I wasn't joking when I said that we've all seen our morale rise over the past few minutes because of this wonderful dinner. And yet morale is a very slippery thing, and I'll try to present that in a number of different ways, because it seems clear to me that morale was an issue that officials in the Canadian Army, both in Canada and overseas, were deeply concerned about. And Jonathan Fennell's book, if you've come across it, it's called The People's War, argues that in a variety of ways, the British Army and the Canadian Army and other Commonwealth armies go through crises of morale in various times, in various ways. And as I say, I think Jonathan's done a wonderful job, but I don't think he fully understands morale in a Canadian context. And so I'm going to play a little bit with those ideas in the course of my next few minutes. I'll do my best to keep your morale up. The question of morale is something that for a lot of us, certainly our attentions have been focused on the Canadian Expeditionary Force. And it's clear, perhaps the first premise of my book, is that the Canadians of the Second World War after 1939 are going to live in the shadow, live in the memory, or perhaps live in the mythology of the CEF. And certainly that was the case if I read the records, which I've been doing over the past few weeks, of C.P. Stacy, who becomes the official Army historian of the Second World War for Canada. And C.P. Stacy's left us all sorts of wonderful little hints. My last book about Carrera's lieutenants was based in large measure on a hint by C.P. Stacy, which he says in the official history that a great deal should be said about the officer corps and how we produced it. And then he says, but I only have time to summarize it in a very short period. And I always thought somehow, after a while I realized that he was laying down a bit of a challenge for me. And in the last few weeks, I think Stacy's laying out a few more challenges for me. There are a series of documents that he created. Stacy went to England and landed in Glasgow after what he describes as a very horrendous trip across the ocean in December of 1940. And he arrives in London into Canadian military headquarters at the beginning of 1940. Late 1940, early 1941, to set up the historical section of the Canadian Army. And he's been essentially hired by Harry Crerar, who's the chief of staff in England for the Canadians, to write or to compile a record of the Canadian experience there. And he's written, and these are digitized now, so they're fully accessible, but I never fully appreciated what he was trying to do in those records. He writes 57 reports in 1941 about the Canadians in England. And the first, one of the first reports he writes is about Canadian military headquarters, which is, if you know central London, it's just off of Trafalgar Square. And in the Sun Life building right beside or right behind Canada House, and Canadian military headquarters is slowly growing up through the floors of the Sun Life building. And he takes extra special pride in noting that the Canadian military headquarters has come under air attack. And so there's almost a sort of certain pride there that the windows have been blown out and people are bricking up the window frames and putting in various ways to protect them. And as Maurice Pope said, who was then working at CMHQ, Canadian Military Headquarters, he said it was really good to be able to say that the top brass were in the line of fire, so to speak, as the air attacks descended on London through 1940 and 1941. But if we read those accounts by Stacy, it seems clear that there is a morale problem. And of course, we can understand why. He first writes the account of the creation of the Canadian Corps. It comes in September 1915, and he writes it in the most glowing terms. That is, the record of the Canadian Corps seems to be the center point or the baseline for his discussion. And he says, you know, oh my gosh, there they are, the Canadians. They come overseas in 1914-15. 8 months later, they take the first gas attacks in Second Ypres in April of 1915. And then he you can see him sort of build up his kind of rhetorical energy, and suddenly there they are at, you know, all the great battles around the Ypres salient, down to the Somme, and of course to Vimy Ridge, and to Hill 70, and Passchendaele in the final 100 days. And then he stops and he says, the Canadian Corps of the Second World War does not have that story to tell. And he describes then a series of near misses in which he describes the Canadians who, remember, the 1st Division has come overseas in the fall of 1939, very reluctantly, as some of us have alluded to already in our discussions. King, as Mike mentioned, you know, King wanted an air training facility. He didn't want a large expeditionary force. So in the fall of 1939, under Andy McNaughton, whose picture is on the opposite side of the screen, we'll take the 1st Division overseas. And if it had been up to King, that would have been the extent of our expeditionary force. The fall of 1940, just after King has won re-election in the surprise election of March 1940, Europe falls. And suddenly the Canadians find themselves in this extraordinary position of near misses. There's a plan, it seems, again under Churchill's guidance, to land an expeditionary force in Trondheim to save the port there from the attack by the Germans in Norway. Canadians get to a port in Scotland and they're pulled back. They're pulled back to their base in Aldershot, west of London. And there's a plan, it seems, to send them off to try to perhaps hold the bridgehead near Dunkirk, where the expeditionary force, of course, the British and the French expeditionary forces, are trying to force a retreat off the beaches there. He describes how McNaughton jumps onto a destroyer, steam across the channel to find out for himself, and it's McNaughton who says, no more troops to Dunkirk, no more troops to France. And then the third expeditionary force, which actually does happen, is one brigade of the 1st Division is sent off to Brest in Brittany. And if you've ever read Farley Mowat's account of it, it's quite marvelous, almost semi-comical. The Canadians get on a troop train, make their way 200 miles inland, when French railway officials say, the Battle of France is over. So they turn around in the same trains and slowly make their way back and are back in Aldershot within 72 hours of that failed expedition. So the start of the Canadian Army's presence in Europe is a dramatically different one than that of what their fathers had faced at the first gas attacks in April of 1915. And I think that from that start, we can argue that there is perhaps a questions about morale that Stacy's concerned about. And he realizes, too, that this is an issue of some considerable import for perhaps obvious reasons. My book, then, I sure wish I could write as quickly as Tim Cook, because I'm drawing a little bit on Tim's record of writing about the cultural history of the CEF. Morale, then, is really an interesting problem because it's a problem that the Canadian Army officials have to define and make some sense of, but it's also something that the soldiers themselves have to define. And that often would, of course, be very different than the official version of what morale was about. But I think by studying morale and by studying some of the efforts that the Canadians faced, some of the challenges they faced in maintaining morale, and those elements suggest that morale goes from being a simple matter of the three M's. And in the initial go, the three M's are money, meals, and mail. We cannot deny the importance of all three. What we see is a quite remarkable discussion of what morale comes to be in the Canadian Army. In fact, it's quite amazing. I came across a memo by the Director General of Medical Services in the Canadian Army. His name is Brock Chisholm, who takes that position in 1942. And some of you might well know of Brock Chisholm, a famous Toronto psychiatrist, joins the Army and initially is in charge of personnel selection. After the war, of course, he'll become the head of the WHO. And we'll tell Canadian families that there's no such thing as Santa Claus. But anyway, that's another thing altogether. Talk about a morale killer right there. But by 1944, he writes to the Adjutant General of the Canadian Army, and he says, we need to change the name of the Directorate of Medical Services, and we should call it the Directorate of Health Services. And he makes that argument because he says we need to define morale in the broadest possible way. We need to introduce social workers and social scientists. We need to create a survey section to detect and understand what morale means. We need to talk about mental health. We need to talk about the problems that soldiers are clearly facing in trying to make that connection back to Canada. One of the elements, I think, of morale that I'm going to look at, and I've got a wonderful computer science student who's trying to help me make sense of this stuff, are court-martial records. Do you know how many court-martials take place in the course of the Canadian Army from 1939 to 1945? I'll give you a hint. 10,000, 20,000, 30,000. Oh, for heaven's sake. Morale can't be that bad. 10,000, 20,000, 30,000. 30,000 court-martials in the course of the war. Now that is a measure of morale too, but it does also reveal a great deal about the state of how so many Canadians understood their place in the Army, understood their place too vis-a-vis their families, many of whom were living in pretty difficult circumstances back home, and that very much dictated their state of morale. So let's talk briefly about heroes and anti-heroes in the Canadian Army here for a second. If I can hit the right button. No, I hit the wrong button. Now, our friend Tim Cook has written extensively about this, and I'm drawing heavily on Tim's stuff for this discussion because he identified in a wonderful article he wrote about 10, 12 years ago, which for Tim means about 300, 400 articles ago, I think. He's a prolific son of a gun. And he talks about the idea of the anti-hero in the Canadian Expeditionary Force during the First World War. And he talks about this idea of how soldiers created their own wartime culture, how they survived their experience overseas, how they understood their experience in this highly regulated, highly disciplined place called the Canadian Expeditionary Force. And so he talks about the ways in which popular culture, such as it was, in this case, a Bruce Barnes father cartoon. I think there is one. There's a Barney's Father cartoon somewhere in this building, if memory serves. Isn't there, Ryan, down in the basement, perhaps? On the, oh, the fifth floor. There you go. We'll have to do a little scavenger hunt to see. And of course, the creation of Barney's Father's old Bill, who's this, you know, scruffy old fellow with a terrible uniform and a beard, clearly somebody who doesn't fall under the regulations of the British Army, who nevertheless seems to survive the ways of the army, manages to cope, manages, I hope, to reflect some element of how the soldier's experience was so very different, perhaps, from that of more conventional records. And this is one of the most famous kind of quotes, I think, from a Barnes Father cartoon. Well, if you know of a better old, and then that constant reference to the British Cockney, then go to it. And it does speak a great deal to the sort of ways in which perhaps the Canadian and perhaps British, well, certainly the British, but by association, the Canadians understood their experience. And Tim goes to great lengths to show how many Canadians write home and say, boy, you know, those kinds of cartoons really did reflect something about our experience, the irony, the tragedy, the kind of dark humor, the language that they could express or found so much more difficult to express except in something like a cartoon, not about a general, not about a grand hero, but about somebody like old Bill. Now, very much then, the 1st Canadian Army after 39 is in the shadow of the CEF, as C.P. Stacey tends to suggest when he first writes in London in 1941. But I think we need to remember, too, that the generation that fights the Second World War is a very different one than the one that fought it in the First World War. They are the sons of the First War veterans. And in many ways, the changes that are developing economically, medically, culturally between the 20s and 30s will produce a very different generation. What my colleague and our colleague at Wilfrid Laurier, Cindy Camacchios, calls the first modern generation. These are the people who will not necessarily die because of childhood diseases. These will be people who will go to high school in an almost universal way and who will become, in a way, adolescents in ways that all of us will now understand, but was a first for them. Popular culture is a powerful force that very much shapes the ways in which people develop their own cultural understanding through that period. And I would argue that as much as the British reference to Bruce Barnes' father is going to develop, Canadians, of course, will, particularly through the rise of film and radio, begin closer ties to American celebrities in the 1920s and 30s. And if you may not know the guy on the left, but was certainly one of the most famous commentators of his era, dear Will Rogers dies in 1939, but by that, 1935. But Will Rogers represents in the American and no doubt North American way this kind of rural yokum who nevertheless has a kind of homespun wisdom that he presents to his performances and to his radio and to his newspaper audiences, which were really quite substantial through the 20s and 30s. And I would argue that in many ways the influence of Will Rogers, the kind of democratic wisdom that he seemed to impart, was important both for American audiences as well as Canadian. And I think we see that in the way in which these cultural kind of markers develop in First Canadian Army. And the guy on the right, I was going to say everybody knows, but I'm looking at that table. You guys don't know who the hell Bob Hope is. Man, oh man, you know. Neither do you. Oh my God, look at that. Do you know who Bob Hope is? All right. Jeez, I didn't think I'd be that old. I'd have to develop who he is. Bob Hope is certainly probably the most popular entertainer in North America at this stage. And again, the rise of radio. In the late 30s, Bob Hope with his smart alecky, kind of cowardly stuff. And, you know, all of us who watch old Turner Classic movies will watch the old road pictures between Bob Hope and Bing Crosby. Sorry, guys, they're really funny. They are bad. I'm trying to find cultural references here that you might understand. And in a lot of ways, he presents this marvelous persona that we watched for 60 years, this kind of cowardly, selfish guy who's, you know, looking at the girls and never quite getting the right girl and all that sort of thing. They all sound terribly dated and terribly sexist, which they were. But Bob Hope was enormously popular in the course of the Second World War when he becomes a kind of traveling one-person show. That's not quite true. He's with a whole coterie of people as he travels not only American installations in the United States and so many different theaters of war. He also comes to Canada. At one point, I do remember Bob, he calls himself Bob Camp Borden Hope. So he's traveling up into Canada, and he's very much then trying to define a certain persona that I think troops very much tended to enjoy. Now, here's the quiz. Ryan brought out of his collection, which is marvelous, the three uniforms over there. And I would argue, I know this is going to be an unbiased, everyone's going to have their own sense of which uniform you'd best wear, right? Ryan was trying to chat up the virtues of the Canadian battle dress. But let's be honest here for a second, all right? If you were going to join one of the three services, Navy is the ones on my right or left. The Air Force. Okay, I hear you. You know, there's a pretty sexy uniform, if you know what I'm saying. I shouldn't use that phrase, but it's attractive, right? And on the right, the Army battle dress. Now, I know there are Naval and Army and Air Force people here, but just purely on the basis of those three, if you had a choice, would you join the Army?
Yeah, okay,
there we go. You had to say that, of course. Now, it's fascinating though, because in when we talk about the three kind of armed services here, the Navy, the Air Force, and the Army, it's clear that in the early going, not only is the Canadian Army narrative really tricky, because not only that after those three failed starts in 1940, the Canadians are going to be given the task of defending Britain. And as much as Charles Stacey likes to put it in dramatic language, it means they're going to be sitting in England for the next few years. They're going to be sitting in Aldershot. And I haven't been to Aldershot, but I understand that it's not... The barracks were built during the Crimean War. During the time of Florence Nightingale, they're cold, drafty. The winter of 1941 is as cold as hell. And the people who live in Aldershot have seen soldiers come and go for 100 years, so they aren't really worried whether they're Canadians or British or whoever. So the idea that morale, you know, from a legacy of we're going to go to France and we're going off to do great things to, well, we might go to Oslo, we might go to France, nope, we're going to be stopped and here we are, would be a considerable issue, dare we say. And it's an issue that in some respects is made even worse by the fact that the Air Force and the Navy, with all due respect, have cooler uniforms. At least they look that way. I think they look that way, but I'm clearly a fashionable kind of guy. The Air Force and the Navy are doing things in 1940 and 41. They're joining the BCATP. My uncle, 18th birthday, out of Kitchener, Ontario, first thing he does is join the Air Force. It's the cool service. Farley Mowat wants to join the Air Force. His old man says, no, you're joining the HDPs, and he goes off to England to join the HDPs. So, you know, it does appear to me as if the Army has a problem, and I guess that's the other issue that I'm fascinated by, is the degree to which the Army has to sell itself. And that sounds odd. But given the way in which the Army is sitting in England, given the problems too that, remember, we don't have really one, we have two armies. And as people begin to complain when the National Resources Mobilization Act, of course, which we've all read, creates conscription for Canadian service, the Navy and the Air Force don't take the conscripts. They all go into the Navy, into the Army. So the Army growing in Canada, both of active volunteers as well as conscripts for the training in Canada, that division is going to create morale problems. And so too then, it's obvious to me that suddenly there is an issue about selling the Army. And this comes fairly late in the war. This is Army Week, late June, July of 1942. And it comes in a variety of ways. It's clear that advertisers are very keen on, you know, sponsoring ads, in this case in the Winnipeg Free Press, and trying to present the Army in an attractive way. And that's a really hard sell, with, again, all due respect to my Army people. Because it does appear as if the Army has been presented, both politically and publicly, as perhaps the less attractive service to the Air Force and to the Navy. And the problems over conscription are further difficulties. And the question about when Canadians will be going overseas and when they'll be actually engaged in fighting are further issues that are confounding Army planners. So in 1942, the issue of selling the Army, I think, is fascinating because it does become a means, perhaps a belated means, of trying to present the Army in the most heroic way possible. And we can see that. I had a student go through the Winnipeg Free Press for me, and there were literally dozens of ads being put in the paper by a variety of people, by a variety of companies, to convey something about the attractiveness, the patriotism that was implicit here. We should also remember, as Professor Toman will tell us, that women are in the Army at this stage. The Canadian Women's Army Corps has been organized as of August of 1941. And so we can see then that there are men as well as women being represented in these kinds of heroic ads. Ooh, I just went past my one. But you can get a sense of the sort of ways in which these tough kind of looking fellas, just an even break pal, guy, good strong forearms there, is hanging onto his Bren gun. I love that one. Maxwell Hell's Coffee is clearly going to lead us to victory with two admiring pretty women and a very handsome looking guy receiving their attention. But as I say, women are in the Army, not only the nursing sisters that Cynthia was telling us about, but also women in the Canadian Women's Army Corps. And a question, I suppose, about morale is fascinating about that, because there almost seems to be a sense that they don't quite know what the Canadian Women's Army Corps people are going to do. And that's an issue that I want to just throw out there quickly, but you can see how these images of young, attractive people sternly looking forward is one way in which the Army is trying to deal, much belatedly, with the issue of actually trying to sell itself. In fact, the Army, both in Canada and England at this stage, there's a survey that I found just prior to this in May of 1942, done by a public polling firm. Polling is a new thing in Canada and North America by this stage, but they're starting to use it in the Army. And they actually do a survey in early 1942 in the Army in Canada, several thousand respondents, long series of answers. And the quick results are is that there is a serious morale problem in the Canadian Army in Canada, perhaps matched by that in overseas. And they say the crucial issue is that the Canadian soldier is not paying full attention to his duties because of his worries about his families at home. And so morale suddenly begins to, they realize, is starting to be connected between one's relationship with civilians back home, with their abilities to be effective trainers and to be effectively trained in the course of the war. In May of 1942, this Directorate of Special Services, sounds very James Bondian, but it isn't. It's an organization that's set up in Canada in response to this survey to try to deal with the issues of morale. And it's really fun to go through the files because they decide it's as if it becomes a kind of clearinghouse for everyone who has an opinion about morale. Send in your suggestions. My favorite suggestion is on the right. They think that the training facilities are a little too bland. You know, these tar paper shacks that are being put up, this one in OTC in Brockville. You know what? What a good way to deal with morale. Let's put red on the roofs and yellow on the shingles and on the fascia and on the door. I mean, I think it's either marvelously optimistic or wonderfully naive, but it's an initiative that they follow along through the course of the time. Sprucing up the training camps is quite big. But morale, they realize, spreads. It has to do with decorations on your battle dress, as Ryan pointed out. It has to do with honors and awards. The Parliamentary Committee is gathering in Ottawa in 1942 in the summer to deal with that very issue. And increasingly to say, how can we have honors and awards that are distinctly Canadian? We're all able to win, well, none of us are able to win the DSO or the MC, but is there a way for us to have specifically Canadian decorations that aren't necessarily British or imperial? Letter writing, mails, one of those three M's. Somebody in August of 1942 says, it's not so much that and this is for the Army overseas especially, it's not so much that mail is not getting through, it clearly is. It's the kind of letters that are getting through. And so begins a year-long campaign to try to have, and of course this is all the women's fault, it's the women who are writing nasty, not nasty, but sometimes, you know, frustrating letters back to their husbands overseas, who've been there now for almost 2 years, saying, you know, the kids are sick, I don't like your mother-in-law, my mother-in-law, and then these are kind of the letters. So there becomes a big campaign in Canada, sponsored by all the newspapers and magazines, to try to get people to write cheerful letters. That, too, is important for morale. No kidding. The other thing that's fascinating, too, is the degree to which we might want to think about Dieppe there, the map that Ryan's put up for us, is, and I'd never really thought of it, because I've been to Dieppe many times, and Mike and I have talked about it at great length, but Dieppe is a huge boost to morale. And we don't often talk about that, because it means that we are in action in France. And there's a great deal of discussion, of course, about the casualties as the casualties develop, and we know that. But in 1942, especially in the Army overseas, morale has gone up. We've finally done something. And we've done something good, and we've proven ourselves. And there are a series, Stacy mentions them, morale reports that are starting to emerge, and the morale reports are based on letters being written home. Initially, they wanted to censor letters to make sure that people weren't saying things that they shouldn't. And they soon realized that nobody was really giving away any information. So they turned the purpose of censoring letters to, as studies of morale. And they had morale reports coming out from August 1941 all the way to the end of the war. Long reports based upon what people thought was important. And for them, going into action in the fall of 1942 is pretty big. Sorry, I keep hitting the wrong button. Lots of things that deal with morale. Entertainment is a huge one. I've always thought this is a big one, and again, you guys won't know who these are. Do you guys know who they are?
Yeah.
Oh, there's a tone over there. I can hear that. All right. I can feel morale dropping in the room as we go. Johnny Wayne and Frank Schuster, Harvard Collegiate graduates. Anyone here from Harvard Collegiate? But you don't remember Johnny Wayne and Frank Schuster, sir. So, you know, U of T grads, they've gone off and done their MAs in English, which is why, you know, they become highbrow comedians on the Ed Sullivan Show after the war. But Johnny Wayne and Frank Schuster are two young guys who are comedians already. They're doing radio shows, and they're recruited into the Army. And their first radio broadcast out of CBC Montreal on December 13th, 1942, is... To me, one of those great kinds of cultural touch points, not only for the Army, but for Canadian culture afterwards. I mean, I had to sit through some of them, so terribly corny, and I'll give you an example. But the format they create on the Army show is exactly the format that we remember from the 50s and 60s and into the 70s, when I'd sit there with my father, who would groan over those terrible puns. This is a script. Frank Schuster was highly organized and left us with so many of the scripts from that period. They're in the National Archives. The only problem is I can't read it. But anyway, the script is about Frank Schuster. It's different. Frank Schuster usually played the straight man, but in this case, Frank Schuster's playing the kind of guy who's coming into the Army. And it goes on about the battle dress, none of the battle dress fit, right? And he says something silly about, you know, you're representing all of Canada. And Schuster says, well, you know, my pants are like southern Manitoba or something like that. And then he says something to the effect that, wait a minute, I got to go over here. Oh, yeah. He says, yeah, I just came in this week, so it's a new recruit. I was thinking of joining the Army for a long time, and yesterday it came to me. What came to you? My letter. Oh, draftee? Yes, I am. Well, I'll just close the window. Okay, you got that. Somehow, anyway. That was considered high, crazy, punish humor. My dad would only appreciate that now. But it's just silly stuff. And then what they do is they fall into a kind of format that, again, we're familiar with from those CBC specials. The orchestra kicks in and they begin to sing these patriotic songs. And then they break into the song.
When the Führer says, "We is the master race, we heil, heil!" Right in the Führer's face, not to love the Führer is a great disgrace, so we heil, heil! Right in the Führer's face.
42, they're kind of coming up with this new way of expressing it. And the Army show, of course, wildly popular. The scripts follow them across Canada. And then, amazingly, they're in England, and they're about 40 days after D-Day, they're in Normandy performing. And with members of the Canadian Women's Army Corps, and they're playing the same Bob Hope kind of shtick. I mean, it really is a kind of Canadian, but it's a Canadian version. It's a Canadian version, honestly. Really, you gotta believe me. Last couple of things here, before I feel the morale slipping from the room. Again, it's amazing to me how late it is that the Maple Leaf newspapers finally put away, or put into press. Not until the Italian campaign, not until January of 1944, in Naples, I believe, does the Maple Leaf newspaper for Canadian troops finally get published. And again, it's wildly popular, you know, Canadian newsmen trying to present not only Canadian news, but English news. After all, many of them had taken up their homes. And the comedy, I suppose, in it also seems to me to reflect much about this anti-hero, but in a very distinctly Canadian way. I put that one up because I went, are they really talking about what I think they're talking about? They're talking about smoking dope. My God, I thought, did anyone smoke dope in 1944? And maybe, you know, it's a parody, it's satire, but it's a curious world that they're kind of making fun of the effects of cannabis in the Italian campaign in 1944. One of the most popular figures that emerges out of this, I contrasted Herbie, a creation of, he's an American cartoonist, but he becomes quickly the kind of favorite of so many Canadian soldiers, is Herbie, the embodiment, it seems, of the anti-hero. Herbie is not the heroic. He's not handsome, he's stooped, his nose hangs down, his uniform is saggy, and he's always getting into trouble. And there's that characteristic question mark above his head to express his constant befuddlement with what has just happened to him, whether it means wrecking a Jeep, whether it means being tossed into the latrines, being tossed into a shell hole, which looks so much like our friend Old Bill, who I put in the beginning. But there's that marvelous way in which Coughlin can express something about the frustrations of Army life that are that would otherwise get you in trouble. And so many cultural ways, the songs, some of them terribly vulgar, are other ways that are tolerated forms of getting at a kind of soldier's sense of how they can understand and tolerate their experience. I want to learn more about this one. This is an attempt by another cartoonist in the Maple Leaf to kind of tie Johnny Canuck, to Monty. And I'm fascinated by that. It does suggest something about nobody's doing that with Andy McNaughton or Harry Crerar. But Monty is increasingly in the 8th Army in Italy, attractive figure. I think he's less so as Canadians follow him in Northwest Europe, but nevertheless, I'd be curious to see if those cartoons persist. To finish, I want to tell you about the guy that I discovered about 2 weeks ago, Mournful Mert. Now, Mournful Mert shows up in the French version of the Maple Leaf. All of us know that calm does not fall to the Canadians until about the 9th, 10th of July, 1944. And about 17 days later, the Canadians have the Maple Leaf coming out of a press building in Caen. And almost immediately do they try to make sure that it's going to one soldier in seven. It's trying to bring together some of the best journalists of the day, like Ross Munro and Matthew Halton, and some of the best kind of commentary. The news from home is absolutely important. And they also create these kinds of mysterious figures who in some respects seem much like the people that we've already talked about, the kind of Bob Hope-ish fellows, the Old Bills from the previous war. But Mournful Mert is a wonderful figure that I found follows the Maple Leaf all the way through Northwest Europe right to the end of the war. Mournful Mert is a complainer. And his musings first appear in July of 1944. I think it's the first issue. And he's a cook somewhere in Normandy. And as we understand from the very beginning of the war in 1939, cooks are absolutely important because the Canadians' morale is declining because they eat British food and they can't stand it. So they decide they have to get Canadian cooks in. Nobody wants to eat mutton. They want to eat Canadian food. So Mert is a kind of funny figure that way. He complains about everything. He complains about the weather and the inactivity. Then he complained about the ride across the ocean, where he was sicker than any guy has a right to be. And in England, where he thought London was the great, where everyone thought London was the greatest city in the world, perhaps to some guys, but it's just a pain in the fanny to me. Take Trafalgar Square, for instance, and they're using those kinds of styles of language that sound a little bit like Will Rogers. Nothing to it, he says, but four lions. And what the hell can four lions do? I ask you. We can hear the tone and perspective of people like Will Rogers, perhaps less Bob Hope. But Mournful Myrtle, like Bob Hope, is very successful, or so he thinks, with women. But he's neither brave nor heroic. There are French girls that he meets, and he tells these marvelous stories about a young girl from Bruxelles, south of Caen, or another woman near Fleury, who he proposes marriage, and he holds her in his arms, just like Ronald Coleman, he says. And then a bomb goes off, and he drops her into the cow shit on the ground, you know? It's terrible. And I just said cow shit. So he's a marvelous figure in trying to kind of pick up women or to deal with the curiosities of army life. And I should mention this for Professor Toman. He takes sick in August, and he has dealings with a nurse. And one of the things that you mentioned, which I thought was fascinating, was, you know, to put a nurse in charge of however many sick men, in a lot of ways, would be an enormous challenge because of the obvious sexism. And there's this great episode in which he's trying to, you know, Mournful Myrtle sort of is telling off this nurse, and he's using terribly sexist language, you know. But the nurse is giving it right back to him and is, you know, saying, how could a man like you, someone of your age, she says, and she just throws it back, someone of your age swearing like that, you know, this terrible language. And of course, she's in power, position of power. It's marvelous. And she goes off to try to actually help him, but he goes off about how, you know, you shouldn't have female doctors and so on like this. So it's a great kind of notion because Mournful Myrtle is the butt of the joke. And the nurse, of course, is playing a far better game here. So in this particular column, known as Shootin The Breeze, do we learn about another anti-hero. Someone who, it seems, has license to talk about their experience in ways that are perhaps reminiscent of the First World War, but are increasingly Canadian. Show you a quick few references to Myrtle as he makes his way through the army. There's his reference to Trafalgar Square and to the girl from Vaucelles. But one thing that's fascinating again is the degree to which so many people, it seemed, just want to go home and they want to be finished with the war. And that too perhaps made them slightly different. And when they get home, they're going to be free of all the army regulation. They're going to flush their uniforms down the loo. They're going to buy the most absurd, colorful clothing that they can. They're going to take a job and then quit because they can. They're going to go down to the local cafe and order 12 eggs and throw 8 of them away. You know, they're going to have a series of choices. Bad choices, but choices that they don't otherwise have in the army. And that, too, I think, speaks to some of the ways in which these anti-heroes give a place for easing the frustration, easing the loneliness, easing the endless homesickness that many of these people faced. So my discussion of morale, as I say, should come to an end, because I know your morale is starting to flag. But let me just finish with one quick remark. First Canadian Army was a remarkable achievement. Some 600,000 soldiers, men and women, volunteers as well as conscripts, played a role all out of proportion to their relative size. It grew from tiny pre-war foundations into hundreds of thousands of citizen soldiers. And even if First Canadian Army could not draw upon the same heroic narrative established by their fathers in the CEF, its soldiers understood the attraction of the anti-hero, a legacy of their father's war. But thanks to radio, film, and army newspapers, figures such as Wayne and Schuster, Herbie, and Mournful Myrtle became popular anti-heroes. They drew upon North American figures like Rogers and Hope, and they were attractive to listeners that longed to return to Canada. They reminded Canadian troops and civilians wary of the army, of the reasons they had enlisted, that army life could be tolerated, the that there was a life to look forward to after the war, and these messages help Canadians resist, as I say, the loneliness, the separation, the frustration, and the discipline of Army life. Thanks very much. Questions for Jeff. I'll give you, I keep looking at you guys trying to kind of make a connection. I can't, you know, because I'm too old. But do you know what Saturday Night Live is?
Yeah.
Do you? Okay, that's good. That's good. It's only been around for 40 years, so that's good. So when it started, Lorne Michaels is still a producer, and his wife was the head writer, Rosie Schuster, Frank Schuster's daughter. Yeah, and so Lorne Michaels, Rosie and Lorne are now split up, but Lorne Michaels, who created Saturday Night Live, is Frank Schuster's son-in-law. No kidding, hey, there's a burst of enthusiasm. Now for the rest of you, Saturday Night Live is a show of that.
You might find it interesting, nurses were often referred to as morale boosters. I'll give you one example from the East Greenstead Burn Unit in England. The soldiers were so badly disfigured and with all these grafts, they really looked rather grotesque.
Yeah.
And the first nurse in the Air Force was Frances Oakes, and I interviewed her when she was 96. She lived to 104. But she was telling me that at East Greenstead, she would walk however many miles it was from her billet to the hospital to work. She'd work her 12-hour shift, and then at the end of the shift, she would change clothes, and she and a bunch of nurses would ram the guys up in wheelchairs and wheel them down to the pub for an evening of activity to socialize, to get back to normal, to get them used to people staring at their disfigurations, et cetera. So I think they were very aware of morale and the importance of the will to live, the will to get through this. What would it take?
Yeah. Thank you, Cynthia.
Oh my gosh, we're having a collision.
Okay, first of all, if anyone in the younger percentage of the group here has seen the movie The Road to El Dorado, that is based on the Bob Hope movies.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, there you are.
Apparently there's even an Easter egg where Miguel and Tulio, the two heroes and heroes characters, are reflected in water, and it temporarily morphs into Bob Hope and
Bing Crosby.
Yeah.
Isn't that neat?
Yep.
Oh my God. All right. I like that.
Now you know. So my question was, so who's your favorite anti-hero comedian
that you mentioned?
During the war?
Yeah.
Well,
don't break.
I gotta say, I still remember growing up Sunday nights watching CBC Toronto, watching Wayne and Schuster, and I thought, in some ways, I thought, this is so bad. Like, it was so cornball, and they'd do the spoofs and everything else. And yet, you know, as I've grown older and thought about the SNL connection, they were really brilliant. And they were, you know, you read about those guys, and they had all sorts of chances to go to Hollywood. They had all sorts of chances to, you know, Ed Sullivan loved them for all sorts of reasons, and they stayed in Toronto. And they always hired Canadian, you know, extras and so on, and I always thought, yeah, good for them. They were good guys. And we don't often talk about that. So I guess that's where, one of the reasons why I decided this project was that I wanted to look at the Wayne and Schuster fonts. So I sit in the archives chuckling to myself like a moron, you know, reading these scripts that Frank Schuster wrote 75 years ago, but it's kind of fun. Thank you, good question.
So this isn't why I came up, but I will share with you that our father's call name was Bing because he was a skinny guy with sticky outie ears. But my mother-in-law was a British war bride, and she just passed this year. And actually, when she was in her early 90s, she passed at 95, revealed that she was actually a sergeant in code and ciphers. But she chose the RAF because she liked the color of their stockings better than the Army.
Thank you. Her vote counts in my straw poll that I had a few minutes ago. It's all about the stockings.
Hi, Jeffrey.
Jim.
Hey, you've raised our morale here.
Well, I hope so. Yeah, now we're done.
What a great Army we had, Calshit and all. And I thank you very, very much for that. And on behalf of the Chief Committee, thank you.
Very good.
Thank you all.
Thanks so much.
This has been another in our series of webcasts produced by the Royal Canadian Military Institute in Toronto as a public educational service. You can find news of upcoming events and links to our webcast archives at www.rcmi.org. On behalf of the RCMI, this is Eric Morse saying goodbye for now, and thank you for joining us.